Get ready. You're about to understand how search engines work, how your favorite streaming service can recommend a show you like, and even how your credit card company can help identify fraudulent charges on your card. It's time for Control-Alt-AI. Vector databases. They power so much of the AI that we use every single day. But what are they? And heck, what's a vector? Let's break it down. Let's start with vector databases at a high level. Well, think back to your childhood days when you're playing with Lego. I loved building stuff with Lego as a kid, but I always found when I was building something pretty complex, I'm always missing that one brick. Maybe it's a certain shape, maybe a certain color that I wanted, and I always had to dig through the box to find the exact one I wanted, if it even existed. Now imagine our box of Legos turned into some kind of magic sorting machine. So I could ask it, hey, I need a 1x4 that's green. And it gives me back perhaps 1x4s that are various shades of green. Or what if we don't have any greens? It gives me like 1x4s that are colors that are similar, like blue or yellow. Now what's a way that it could do this? Well, if you've ever seen someone who collects Lego as an adult, you've probably seen their amazing collections. And they're usually cataloged in some amazingly strategic way, with groupings of colors and shapes. So when they come up with needing a certain brick or shape or color, they know exactly where to go look because they've categorized and kind of grouped those bricks together already. That's exactly how a vector database works. They take vectors and store them in such a way that lets them not only recognize features of a specific piece of data or object, but also to recognize them based on similarities between other objects. Now, we're probably familiar with SQL and NoSQL databases. And if we were going to store information about Lego bricks in a database, we would probably have a bricks table that looks something like this, with different columns for different attributes, like our size and our shape and our color. Now, that's fine if we're trying to look for a brick that's 1x4 and blue. But what if we had records in there that showed indigo as the color, or navy? A SQL database isn't going to easily see the similarity between those bricks. The same goes for NoSQL databases. We can easily define an object that represents that brick, but being able to query and find similarities that we don't explicitly define is going to be difficult. But that's exactly where a vector database shines. It's going to store those data points as vectors rather than the actual featured data, so that the similarities in those objects are more easily recognizable to it. Now, holy free holy, Michael. All I see is numbers. Well, heck yeah, you do. That's one sweet looking vector, right? So I guess before we move on, we need to discuss two other topics that are just foundational to vector databases: vectors and embeddings. So what is a vector? Well, in its simplest form, it's just an array of numbers or an array of numbers. But that doesn't really tell us the what of vectors. So let's break it down a little further. Imagine we want to model daily temperature data. That means we'd probably want to keep track of the daily low, a mean temperature of the day, and maybe the high. Well, if we remember that a vector is just an array of numbers, well, we might want to model the data like this, with, say, 20 was the low, 29 was the high, 24 was the mean temperature. Makes sense, right? Now, we could call those high, low, and mean numbers properties or attributes of a day's temperature. But we're going to call them dimensions, and I'll explain why later when we get back to vector databases. But from here on out, when you hear me say a dimension or dimensions, understand I'm just talking about a specific feature of a piece of data. Now, knowing that a vector is just an array of numbers or array of numbers, we can see how we would apply that to a Lego. So we might have a property for height, for depth, for length. But what happens when we get to things like shape and color? Those are strings, not numbers. If you just realize that we're about to talk about embeddings, congrats, you're right. Embedding has dual meanings. First, it's the process we use to create vectors with deep learning, but also the vectors that we generate using that process are called embeddings. Yeah, we're not great at naming things. So how does that work? Well, that's a great question. Let's use our Lego data to kind of explain that. Let's pretend that our model is going to keep those numeric values just as they are for those dimensions or features. But for that color column, our model is going to use that value to create a new number that's going to represent not just that value, but also how that value relates to other values. So the resulting vectors might look like this. Oh man, Michael, how does it do that? Well, we're not going to go into the depths of deep learning. We already covered that a little bit in a previous video, so click on the cards up there if you want to learn more about it. But for now, we're just going to assume that we give a piece of data to a deep learning model. It converts that into a vector that it gets used later in another model, and it's a vicious cycle, I tell you. But now at least we have a basic understanding of what vectors and embeddings look like. Seriously, I told you, it was just an array of numbers, or an array of numbers. Try to say that three times fast. But remember when I said we were going to refer to those features as dimensions, and then we'd talk about them later? Well, it's later. While we may not understand all the numbers in that vector, we do understand that they represent not only the value of that feature, but how that value relates to other values in that same dimension. Let's look at some vectors that we might be more comfortable with. If we imagine these as being just x and y axes on a graph, well, we can kind of see where we would plot those out, and immediately we can envision what items are more similar to others. But what if we dial it up a notch and add another dimension? We've just added a third dimension that now makes it a little bit more complex. And luckily, our brains can still kind of understand and see how those things might be similar, but it's getting a little more difficult for us. But what if we added a fourth dimension and a fifth dimension? I can't even draw that. That's beyond what my brain comprehends. And we are literally getting to the point of mind blown. But not for vector databases. This is exactly what they were made for. They're able to look across n levels of dimensions and see similarities between our data that we can't even comprehend and begin to pick up on. Okay, but let's put it all together. We kind of understand what vectors are. We know that embeddings are just translating things that aren't numbers into vectors that can be stored, right? And we understand that a vector database is plotting all that stuff out in n dimensions where n is the number of features of our data. So storing that. So we get that part of it, but then how do we search it? How does that work? We're used to querying with SQL and NoSQL, where our queries are a little more defined. We can say, give me a brick that's 1 by 4 and it's green. But that's not how our data is stored in a vector database. We can't say, give me a brick that's 1 by 4 with a color of 3.2. We don't even know what 3.2 is. We need to be able to say, give me a 1 by 4 that's green. But remember how we used a model to create those embeddings? We'll do something similar with our query. We'll say, give me a 1 by 4 by green. And what we're actually doing is saying, hey, turn that query into a vector of its own. So it generates a 1 by 4 by 3.2 and says, hey, vector database, if you were to have this vector, where would it live in your space? And maybe tell me the 5 items in your space that are most similar to the one I'm giving you. Boom! Did your mind just explode? Think about that. Your streaming service can say, hey, this user just watched show Y. What is the vector for show Y? It's this. Hey, database, show me the 5 most similar shows to this vector in that space. It comes back out. There's your top 5 recommendations. Or take your credit card provider. They take in a transaction, convert that into a vector, send it to the database and say, hey, does this transaction live in the same space generally as all the other transactions for this person? If not, there's possible fraud here. I told you, this stuff is bonkers and crazy cool. I hope you're enjoying learning about AI as much as I am. Is there a topic about AI you want to learn more about? Or do you have a use case that you think would be great for vector databases? I'd love to learn more about that too. So leave it in the comments below. Until next time.